and curatorial advisor for Wally Flower Photomedia Gallery, Mildura. She currently lectures at Photography Studies College, Melbourne. Katrina.
Hi, happy, privileged to be here. Thank you all for coming and for sticking around today. I thought, what am I going to do with this talk? I thought I'm not going to, is that too loud or something? Yeah? I thought I'm not going to, I thought I was going to talk about some other works other than Dickris, which most of you have probably perhaps seen at the beauty boarding, which I'm showing here. And most of those works that I want to be showing are works in progress, which is also something I suppose we don't often kind of share with others, which is something I don't understand. And I just really wanted to really quickly kind of start by talking about something that happened to myself when I was younger that I really think is very important. In I always like this idea of knowing where someone comes from in the stories that they tell, and I kind of think, you know, past experiences are extremely important to form kind of the narratives that you become interested in. So when I just left school, my childhood friend Tobias, who I went to school with, and his mother is my godmother, he died in a plane crash above Iceland. And he was really into photography. He was super passionate about it, and he had this old Minolta with thousands of weird filters and things. And so I took his camera and went to Iceland for 3 months to kind of be with the loss, I suppose, and make sense of it. And, you know, somehow this thing of walking at night with the camera was really kind of, it sort of made me feel closer to him somehow, and it made me feel kind of okay at the time, I suppose. And it made me feel an immense sense of urgency in everything that kind of surrounded me. But what happened with that was actually that I got back to Germany, and I'd never shot on a film camera before. And so all the film actually came out pitch black, which, you know, initially was frustrating, but then I really quickly kind of understood that actually there was something to that that needed to be exactly in that way somehow. They're not there. And so as a sense, thinking about my general practice, this is really kind of a crux thing, which in a sense is my practice. I often deal with, I don't know, you know, things that are kind of on the limits of a representation. So ideas of states of mind, for example, feelings. I mean, how, you know, Dickris, it's the same kind of thing. I mean, how do you photograph things that are there but kind of not, in a way. So it's sort of, you know, the felt versus the seen, an image that exists and that doesn't, somehow. It's also like this kind of ignition of my practice was very much in the presence of absence, and I think that's something that has a coherence throughout a lot of my work as well. And it's in a way to this idea of kind of like, you know, looking at narrative as a way of presencing absence, I suppose. So very early on, right from the start, photography became something to me that was, without knowing it then, I suppose, you know, of course I couldn't articulate it then, but I can now, a way of sense making and of being in and with the world, I suppose, and of navigating my experience, looking at what it means to be, I suppose, be alive, what things mean around me. I think my work, I don't really make declarative work. Rather, I think it's kind of the product of, what I do is the product of me using my visuality to talk about what it is that something teaches me while I make work about it, like a landscape, a death, my mother, rubbish, all sorts of things like this, you know. Of course, all of this work is therefore also subjective and highly personal, which it has been. So generally, having Australia 13 years ago, there's also, of course, this sense that informs my work, all of my work, which is through this sort of story of movement through language and culture and continent. I suppose I'm really interested in what it means to be home, to be belong, to place, what it means to be in a place, to become part of that place. How do we do that? How do we think about that? And so, you know, also our sort of emotional connections to place, of course. So I'm going to talk, the first work that I want to talk about grew out of something else called Nia, which is, I started in 2005 when I was studying at the Queensland College of Art. That was a sort of very, very long-term documentation of my family, and it was sort of about love and distance and, you know, being scattered all across the globe. So it was about this kind of agony of being apart and looking at family narrative more generally, I suppose. And so this kind of migratory experience already informed that work. But it was... anyway, so out of that work grew this body of work that I wanted to show you, which is called Indefinitely. And I think... sorry. This work is, the language in Indefinitely is kind of changed from Nia. In this work, I'm no longer interested, the themes are very similar, migration, family, distance, you know. But I'm no longer interested in really showing the family as it is or describing the distance between us, but rather I want to kind of rethink the space that is between us, i.e. like Melbourne, South Africa, Australia, New Zealand. So this space that is the in-between. I kind of thought, like, I really want to visualize what an experience of this distance may feel like in a kind of free way. And, you know, it's something that I'm interested in general is, like, the idea of the emotionality of a picture, its ability to move. So I was kind of wanted to use a language that was going to talk to that. Something that I've been thinking a lot about for years is that, and... you know, this migratory space has a sort of dark narrative convention, you know, it's empty, it's, I mean, you and partly you experience it like that, of course, as well, and it hurts. But I really wanted to employ or find for myself a kind of counter language to that, and one that helped me almost personally, just for me, to undistance the distance that was between us. So I suppose, in a way, the language that I'm using is a very suggestive, you know, it's sort of about something seen, but also something imagined, hybrid, non-didactic. I think a lot about this kind of thing of language and around pictures as well, and how language, the relationship between language and the world, and how language is this kind of thing that sort of also really informs how we see what we see, how we read place, and how we understand a place, I suppose. So in this body of work as well, there's some marker pictures. I mean, this is a picture. There's pictures even. This one was made by my grandmother a long time ago. I don't even really know where, to be honest. But so I was thinking, making this work, which is a very long form body of work, which is kind of the way that I work with everything. Years and years and years, I return to things a lot. That's kind of my methodology, I suppose. This idea of returning, for me, has to do with knowing something. You know, returning to it, you get to know it, and the knowing means you get to love it, I suppose. And then I feel like I can talk about it with authenticity if I get to make this process happen for myself. So. I was thinking about all the things that fill this space, quite literally between us, as a sort of family, you know, and I was thinking, this is insane. Like, I mean, if you think about it, it sounds pathetic, but actually, you know, this everything is in that space between us. So trees, oceans, languages, animals, chairs, books, you know. So this in-between is the one thing we all have in common as well, which is the world. And I suppose rather than feeling the in-between as something empty, I wanted to make it full of world. The work is also kind of, if you can see it, it's like it sort of has a placeless kind of feeling to it as well, which is, of course, a very conscious thing. I didn't want to make something that was talking about this experience in a way that was going to be tied to geography or nationality or any kind of thing like this. You know, I wanted to be free, floating, something shared. So, you know, by employing this placeless kind of language, I really did want to make this shared kind of experience outside of the family unit, of course. And I suppose in a way create a kind of new and somewhat placeless locality. I suppose a felt locality, perhaps. So the pictures are really over, 7, 8, 9 years, made all over the place. You know, Australia, New Zealand, but also not only those places where my family kind of resides, but also the sort of spaces in between, I suppose. So the work is in the world, but it also, to me, it feels like something. And it, you know, it has a very strong documentary methodology, I think, and documentary thinking. But it sort of creates this kind of dream space somehow, a drift space, which is disorienting, which I like. The people in the pictures, my family, of course, they're all this kind of photographed in a sort of, you know, floating state as well. It's for me, it throws up questions of, I think the picture is a bit cut, doesn't matter. Questions of, you know, like what I'm questioning. I mean, what are they doing? Are they awake? Are they sleeping? Are they dreaming? Are they alive even? It's sort of like looking at this, questioning our very state of consciousness. What does it even mean to be in a place? Are you in a place when you dream, when you're asleep? Of course you are, but how is that different? So this hybridity of experiencing place, an experience of it that has no fixed coordinate, which also is something that reflects in the title of the work, this sort of indefinitely, that there's no fixed coordinate and that there's no time frame, or like that's sort of something that just is and has no boundary in that sense. You know, it presents as something infinite and inner and outer place, feeling and being, the world of body and mind, and the world of world. So to me, the work moves the experience of migration from something lonely into something shared, like I said, I think, of course. And I think geography, memory, and absence all sort of mingle into this, into something akin to a new idea of presence. This picture for me is This picture for me is a marker picture within the greater series. It was my nan made it, who had migrated to Colombia, and I'm not sure. I mean, I made it during a family slide night, and so it was kind of like this sort of collective viewing experience as well, which heightened this sense of trying to make sense of this picture. And you know, where was she coming from? Where was she going? Was she arriving? Was she departing? So the sense of the body of work, of course, is very important. So I think a lot about this idea of, you know, the camera as a, especially also with, because of what I said earlier about this idea of, well, how do you talk about something that's there, but kind of not, you can't, it's not a chair that you can grab and photograph. And so this camera as a tool to enable us to give story to things, I suppose, you know, like this picture here, for example. I mean, some sand in the air. To me, it's a face, of course, you know.
And it sort of renders visible, doesn't it? Which is incredible. And it you know, it means it makes be. So another thing that I do all the time is that I work in, I'm not sure why, but I've always worked this way, that I work in kind of lots of different stories at any given point. And some people have said to me in the past, you're mad, like why would you torture yourself like that? But it's, I don't know, I think it's just the way that I work, and I've tried to change it, but it doesn't work. And I think the different kind of stories, and they're all very long form, of course, and they kind of really do inform each other as well, you know? I mean, sometimes they don't work, of course, but I think they inform each other a lot. And so the work grows in different kind of ways alongside each other. That's my dad, who has a mice phobia, and he was heard something when we're sitting at the kitchen table and jumped up to look at the attic to see if there were mice there. But to me, you know, again, like, I mean, looking at this picture within what I'm trying to talk about, it represents something else. It's this idea of looking out for something, you know, the idea of distance. I mean, so another body of work that I want to show you, and super, super in progress. I mean, some of these pictures I've never even shown anywhere or something like this, even though they're older, actually. But it's called The Crossing, and I've been working on it for quite a number of years. Last year, I had a couple of first showings of a small part of it at the ACP and the CCP in Sydney and Melbourne, which was really great. But it's super in progress, and I don't intend to actually finish it anytime soon at all. Sorry if some of those pictures might be a bit dark on this screen. So again, it's a very, very long form body of work, and it grew out of something called Lake Mountain that I've also been working on since 2009, which is when I moved to Victoria from Queensland in Australia. And the Lake Mountain is very much about this sort of alpine region in Victoria, a couple of hours out of Melbourne, that was severely hit by the Black Saturday bushfires in 2009, and of course changed forever. So it talks about, it tries to look at climate change and the sort of aftermath of fire on the land and things like this. So The Crossing is kind of grown out of that, and alongside with it, I suppose, it's looking at ecology and human impact. And it was started off just over the last years, just being engaged with Australia and those ideas in Australia. But I think it's slowly also moving outside of that, which is important to me, because obviously it's not a purely Australian issue, of course. So I've sort of learnt, a bunch of years ago, I learnt about the Anthropocene when it wasn't, which I suppose you all know, this sort of proposed, or even more already kind of, approved or something like this, geological epoch, in which, you know, this, we've touched everything, and it's sort of the era of human intervention and interference. And so I was reading a lot about this, and I still am, and I think it really became something that was, to me, I'd been making works, and I couldn't kind of make sense of, I knew they were going somewhere and they were doing something, but I wasn't quite sure. And I think it was only when I kind of first started coming across this idea of the Anthropocene and reading about it and really engaging and embedding myself into research around it, that I kind of felt like, actually, okay, this is quite significant to me in terms of that work. So, you know, Anthropocene, obviously, it's ideas of ecology's impact, agriculture, image cultures, violent legacy of white dominance, the weight of war on the world, language, capitalism, globalization, the virtual. It has an enormous complexity. And I mean, I don't, again, it goes back to the idea of declarative work, but rather it's just my way of engaging with what the hell does that mean? What does that mean? What is the Anthropocene? This is so epic. You know, how do you, it's really me just finding out a little bit, or trying to anyway. The work is really very deeply inspired by, I suppose maybe some of you might know of him, Michel Serres, French philosopher, amazing mind, who in 1990 wrote this most incredible genius book, I would say, or work of urgent sort of poetry, and it's called The Natural Contract. I really recommend, I mean, if anyone is interested in kind of ideas around, you know, ecology and thinking with around the land and our responsibilities to that. I mean, this book is, I think, incredible. So the Anthropocene has widely been yielded as something profoundly aesthetic because it sort of describes a new look of the earth in which, you know, a sort of new face of the earth in which we've, which of course has been building and building. It's not like it's just come overnight, but this idea that it looks really different from what it used to, or like feels also, and is experienced, I suppose, different to what it used to be. And so this new face that has been made by us, and so therefore might beg for another language to be read and fully comprehended, to ready us to recognize our responsibility, and individually, particularly as well, I think, you know. So, again, with this work, like, I'm not interested in mapping an aftermath or something. I'm not really, I mean, I was really thinking about a lot about like this kind of language thing, and what is it that I'm trying to say here, and you know, what is it that I'm trying to do, and I wasn't interested in describing something or showing it, but rather making it felt. And I really wanted to this question of what is at stake right now, which to me is kind of everything, I suppose, you know, that was really something that I needed to find a way to visualize, or like for myself anyway, to attempt to visualize this kind of poking at things that are at stake. And I was thinking, you know, I know what a factory looks like, I know what a mine looks like, I need to find some other way somehow to try and do this. So I really was interested in finding a language, I suppose, that can in some way create a platform of empathy, a kind of language of love somehow, maybe. Definitely something that, you know, pictures, I really wanted to make pictures that, and still do, I mean, it's in progress, that don't further the distance between the represented and the spectator and the man and world, but rather draw closer, you know. I wanted to extend the experience of the audience through immediacy, I suppose. Language that made us that sort of makes us feel what we're talking about is not something outside of ourselves, but rather a part of ourselves, and, you know, it really, really matters. So we're kind of talking about ourselves by looking at damage we've done, you know, of course, and the land. Michelle Serres talks a lot about he talks a lot about how we've as a humanity, we act like Earth itself now, you know, we act like tectonic plates. There's this weight, our collective weight on the world, and that's something that I think about a lot in my daily life, but also as part of this work, of course. The work is, I think, the narrative sort of emerges and becomes becomes something by way of image pairing very much as well. Again, the project sees me return to lots of sites of impact, not necessarily meaning at all that then I will photograph those sites necessarily. Rather, I will feel my way around them, and I will kind of make something with this. So that, you know, the one on the left, for example, was a piece of, there was a dried out river bed it was dried out through prolonged irrigation damming. And so, like, I found, it was in South Australia, and I found all these, that's the turtle was made there actually as well. Bits of animals and remains and this cracked earth. So another thing that really is important with this work for me is that I was thinking, okay, but I really in thinking about photography and the land and experience of the land, and especially thinking about impact and, you know, like often I felt like there's a lot of photographs that don't, that of course they're all bearing art traces, so we're all over those scenes, but I really felt like, you know, we need to be, I want us to be, I want there to be a human presence, like a body presence as well, in some of this work. That was really, really important to me, and of course super difficult, because I don't know, I mean, how, you know, I don't walk around and set things up, and so it's, you just make and wait and make and wait, and I felt like if we weren't going to be in the pictures, then it would suggest that we're not responsible. And again, I feel like it would have separated us from the world. So I think the work is a kind of creative and imaginative documentary thinking. Brings things into sort of different dialogues, and does the rules of the linear, the straight, I think the expected, perhaps, for myself anyway. And it puzzles it all together into something else that, again, speaks to a very felt and experiential kind of experience of what it means to be in this environment and in this time, and to be responsible as well. You know, I mean, a lot of the titles are actually very important, which I, of course, I can't really talk about here, but they're informed also by Serez and this amazing bunch of people in the States. They're called Bureau of Linguistical Reality, that are trying to find a sort of new another language. They're trying to make up words for describing land in Anthropocene, and so it's very interesting, super hard. They're inviting everyone to kind of like come up with words, but it's the hardest thing on earth. But so the titles are very informed by that, and a lot of the titles also bear my own impact. So, for example, like this picture here. So, like, or anything that is an aerial picture will have as part of the title will bear the aircraft that I was on when I made this picture, and the number, of course. Where was I? So Serez says, you know, we don't know the language of the world, actually, the land world. And there's this beautiful, beautiful little quote that I love a lot by Norman McCaig in his Luskentyr poem. And he says, "Scholars, I plead with you, where are your dictionaries of the wind?" So in something called The Old Place, Godard and his wife Anne-Marie Miviel, they talk about this kind of, they argue that there exists, and this is from, sorry, it's a bit older, 2001. Back then, they argued in this film that there kind of exists a groundlessness of vision and a lack of images of the world and of humanity. And they go on to suggest that they say, we're all less lost in the immensity of the universe and in the depth of our own spirit. There is no way back home. There is no home. The human species is blown up and dispersed in the stars. We can neither deal with the past nor with the present, and the future takes us more and more away from the concept of home. We're not free, as we'd like to think, but lost. It really resonates with me. Not that I'm totally hopeless, but I think there's a lot of truth in that to me. Robert McFarlane also suggests, following on from this idea of the kind of lack of imagination or something, especially in our, you know, visually crazy literate and saturated culture, it's like this idea of talking about the world, this idea of rewilding our language. This is Robert McFarlane, another really quite amazing writer and thinker. So there's this has lots of, it's my way of finding out about this and researching it. And so it has lots of different kind of, like before when I sort of talked about how Anthropocene and me thinking around it is, not just the impact of something in the land on what's at stake, but actually all these other things, of course, that have everything to do with where we're at right now, you know, so the Weight of War chapter, kind of, that's not its title, but it's just my thinking around it, is something that I've been working on for a bunch of years now, archival pictures. That was not part of the exhibitions. To also talks, of course, to colonialism. has to, huh? And what has war done on the world, on the land? So it's really something that I'm doing, and I'm just interested in this idea that there should be, or like I believe that we need some kind of new ecological imaginary somehow. I really think like this Sarah's when he says we don't know the language of the world, I feel like we don't, certainly in the West, the last little thing that I'll show you, I just thought it would be nice actually to show, just because I've got, where's Protik? Protik. Well, Protik and I made a book together last year with Shaw's Commune, French, beautiful French, small publisher, independent. And some of these pictures are in the book. And I kind of thought, and of course there's Protik's amazing exhibition upstairs, and I kind of thought it would be nice to show some of these pictures. So, with these pictures, the idea or the body of work, again, is something that I'm also still working on. I was thinking around faculties of seeing and how, you know, like we only see really what we want to see. So I was very interested in kind of, in a very playful way, you know, just in a very playful way to kind of think around this idea of how we only see what we want to see. And I was interested in looking at lending visibility to what we deem insignificant and unworthy, I suppose. You know, so like this whole idea actually started with one day I was walking to work and this kind of piece of rubbish was lying on the ground and it was just glowing like crazy. And I thought, whoa, like, you know, so of course if I bent my head this way, it wasn't. And I just thought, wow, actually this kind of the sun hitting the surface of that thing transforms it into something else, which is nothing new, of course, but I mean, it was incredible that I felt like, wow, no one's looking at this thing, you know, it's not rubbish anymore, it's, I don't know, something magic, something incredible. So sort of like a process of unseeing the familiar, re-seeing it, that sort of idea. This is, for example, this is a puddle behind my mother's house in the forest in Germany. That puddle is always there. It's kind of like a big, so I, like every time I'm there, I return to this puddle. And never lets me down. So yeah, it's banalities. It's the everyday. It's my immediate surroundings. Actually, it's all of my work anyway. It's always very much what's immediately around me and has to do with my life, of course. So the trivial, the grand and the trivial. And you know, thinking around, what does that do to us when we see the same thing again and again and again and again? And it can kind of tire us. But actually, it's our choice, really, isn't it? Like, I mean, you know. You can look at it differently, and birdshit can be a universe, I suppose, so it's up to us, I think. So the light is all ambient, found. It's sunlight reflecting off a surface. It just all depends on how I position myself to that, of course, both of those. It's abstract work, you know. There's no hierarchy of subject matter there for me. It's trying to ask, I suppose, for a repositioning of whatever it is that you think you're looking at and you think you know you're seeing in a way. I mean, this was one of the earliest kind of works. Oh, yeah, I think so. That was one of the rubbish pieces that on my way to work. Which, of course, you know, there's actually a lot of, in the sort of grander work, there's loads of rubbish is something that just, I don't know why, but I keep, it keeps cropping up always. Yeah, I mean, you know, you could see it as a comment on waste culture, but I don't really think of it necessarily like that at all. I just think, to me, it's more about this agency of something and the shift in the agency of something. Again, it's a work that for me very, very much comes back to this idea of, which, you know, is something that I've really felt very crazily when Chris ended his life. How, you know, I had these moments where I would walk up the road to the corner store and I'd just feel this, you know, I'd just watch this tree blowing in the wind and you know, I'd see that tree, I see it all the time. But it was just this kind of, his exit gave this huge sense of urgency to absolutely everything. It came back to Tobias as well, of course, but with Chris, I think it was even more intense because his death was, different to Tobias's, which was accidental. And this urgency, and this is in this work for me as well, how the small things are equally as important, actually, if not perhaps more important. So, you know, this kind of thing of the thingness of the broken glass, the thingness of us and the thingness of the universe are all this thing together, somehow that matters, actually. So for me, through lived experience and through loss, and there is this heightened sense of urgency, and it made me realize I'm most interested to make a language that translates the found into something seen and felt and experienced, and borrows from the world in a certain way, but then shifts it into the personal through the particular, my particular way of interpretation, and by positioning myself, of course, to the world that I am a part of and that I'm seeing, and then to give it back to the world in a kind of a different language, I suppose. I just think that, yeah, ending a talk is always tricky, isn't it? Yeah. Again, I mean, you know, this is, for example, this work is not, it's not, it's very different to Dear Chris, in a way, you know, I mean, but I think it's again, it goes, it's something that in the same way as Chris, almost for me personally, positions me in the world with a sort of responsibility that I'm thinking about all of the time, and it doesn't matter whether that can be playful or any other way, but as a sort of 21st century storyteller who's equipped with the tools of language and communication, of course, and who's a citizen, you know, a citizen in this kind of out of balance, very, very out of balance, globalized world that is, I suppose, in need of a common language, I think. I think that's it.
Any questions? Liz.
Hi, Katrin. Thank you very much for that. It was very interesting to see and very interesting to feel the emotional depth of your approach to photography.
Thank you.
But I have a specific sort of, which might be a set of questions or might stop the moment I ask the first one. I was wondering, when you talk about long form, whether you are consciously referencing long form in Tai Chi. With
long form what? Sorry, Liz.
In Tai Chi.
And no.
No,
and
okay.
No, so then
because all the other questions would come out of the analogy. No.
I should change it to long term or something like this.
Maybe. Yeah.
That's a very good tip.
Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions? Daniel.
So not Tai Chi, but with long form, when do things start to feel ready for you? When do they? How do you feel when things start to crystallize? When you've, because you collect over a very long period of time these things, what is it with some of the work that does feel finished to you? When did it feel that moment?
There's no kind of formula for an answer to that. To be honest, you know, it's like, I mean, it's the thing. How do you, as photographers, like we all are, how do you know that? I mean, maybe sometimes with Dear Chris, for example, actually it was very obvious because it was very limited, you know, the whole around the idea or the project was very much contained in itself. Chris was absent, you know. So of course there was going to be grand limitations to that. But then in other works, it goes back like to this thing, like with Lake Mountain, for example, since 2009, I've been photographing there, and actually really, it's kind of like, and you know, I'm working on a book with a Melbourne publisher on that at the moment, and but I don't feel like I even want to finish it, and it's not really about, it's almost like me, the camera, it's sort of my way of being there, and of course I will, if I stop photographing there, I'll go back still, you know, but it's kind of this process of keeping to understand the things around me, and it's kind of part of my life, I suppose, in the sense of like it informs, it makes me, enables me to ask questions, you know. And so this family thing as well, I mean, it kind of like the distance hasn't stopped, you know. My feeling of the distance hasn't stopped, so therefore it feels bizarre to just kind of go, oh yeah, that's like done now or something, you know. Does that make sense? It's probably not very, maybe it's not a sort of a normal approach, I don't know, but.
Katrin, do you ever worry about losing your audience? Or, I mean, does that ever make you, like, does that ever factor into decisions that you make your work?
How do you mean losing the audience?
As in, you know, you talk about the need for a more common language.
Mm-hmm.
So do you feel like an audience follows you and what you're trying to say? I mean, I don't know if that makes sense.
Like, I don't quite understand. As in, like, they might tire of my work?
No. So do you think that people might find your language too complex? Does that even occur to you? Does it factor into decisions that you make about your work when
the audience? Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's, you know, I think it'd be pretentious to say the audience doesn't matter and you'd be doing it for yourself or something. Like, it doesn't work that way, does it? I mean, the audience is incredibly important, you know. And again, like I was actually telling Liz the other day, for example, with Dear Chris, it's a sort of, you know, it has very poignant kind of titles. And so by, for example, seeing these titles with the works, it extends the understanding of the experience of the work, you know, which of course is something I would do for the audience, you know. So yeah, I mean, I think about audience a lot.
Please.
When you work on a project, like, I'm pretty sure there are some things that you want to find out or you want to find a resolve when you start on a work inside yourself. Like, so when you come to a point, do you find that through your work you find some kind of resolve in yourself or some kind of emotional resolve that you are seeking through your work?
No, I think it's... I mean, emotional result.
Resolve.
No, it's neither nor. Yeah. No, I don't think it's neither nor. I think it's for me very much not really. It's not really about the process of making work. Is not process of practice to me is not about finding an answer. Actually, it's more about, you know, raising questions. I think for myself as well. And of course, you have findings within that process for sure. And then you move on from that, and then you have another question. And I think it's very much how it works for me.
Thank you.
Do I see any more hands? Up there, down below.
Ah. Alicia?
Just to be a little contrarian, given how concerned you are with the Anthropocene and with the fact that people are not really paying attention to that time which is coming, like outside of the scholarly community. I actually don't think, at least in this part of the world, people are really aware of that term and like how it's evolving and the way it's taking over. There's also like a, in some ways, an anti-historical nature to your work, for me. An anti-historical nature to the work because of how untied it is to anything, right? Like the placelessness, it's everything and nothing. And how do you work? It's a dangerous space, like for me, of working with abstraction while being very deeply concerned with present day issues. I think how do you deal with that danger of like your, like, I think my question is actually similar to Nayantara, which is your audience actually losing all sense of your concerns while they're looking at the work, and it becoming a place of pure introspection, mm-hmm. About whatever it is. If your concern is with specific issues which might be broad, you know, mm-hmm. So how do you counter that?
Obviously, does that still work?
Sorry?
Is this still working? Sounds like it's not. Oh, okay. Well, obviously, the work that I showed here was only a snippet, you know? So it's a much greater, here we go. It's a greater work, of course, and, you know, there are, I think, that sort of, again, going back to that sort of thinking around marker pictures, of course, there are pictures that are much more descriptive, for example, that anchor the ideas into, okay, here's this, let's say this mine, for example, that I've been returning to, or here is this cattle industry, you know. So, it, of course, there are those things there as well. I did not put them into the talk for the idea of, yeah. Mm-hmm.
What about text, Katrin? Are you, like, actively avoiding text? Or any plan to integrate text or anything like that?
The crossing?
Yeah, yeah.
No, I'm not actively avoiding text at all. As I said again, it's a body of work where the titles are very important, I think, to me, you know. So when I show it, I make sure that the titles have a place. And I mean, I write, of course, around the work, and but I don't see it as a body of work that sits with panels of didactics or something like this, actually. That's not how I really see it.
Anyone else? Okay. Oh, please go ahead.
I try to, put my thoughts together because I think I understand some of those questions where mm-hmm. they are coming from. I know you. I know your work, and. Again, we are talking about the aboutness mm-hmm. of a certain series. And I have to say, I would be really happy just to see the crossing and the images and not know anything about it. Mm. It would have such a deep effect on me. Mm-hmm. As soon as I have all this theoretical background from you, I try to match it with the pictures. Mm-hmm. And most of us can't. And because you say the titles are missing, it's a new work, it's a work in progress, it's a challenge. But there's a certain tradition in photography where the aboutness is really important. Mm-hmm. And I'm on the other spectrum, yeah? So I know that kind of like challenge and the tension between those two poles, and maybe this is what we are talking about. Mm,
perhaps, yeah. I didn't think that was a question that required an answer. That was more
of
a statement.
A comment, yeah, yeah. Because I thought maybe I can add something.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay. Well, thank you very much,
Katrin.
Yeah. Now, just for some announcements for tomorrow, there is a slight change because two of our artists have not been able to make it, so we had to make some slight changes, and I'll just announce that. What I also want to tell you is all of this is being live streamed. It's also on our Facebook page, so if you get the chance, do let people know. Share that, like it, or whatever, so more people know that this is available online. It will be archived as well, but at the moment, everything we're doing is being live streamed, so we need your help to let other people know that that's happening. Okay, for tomorrow at 10:30, this is at Patshala. The educational programs take place at Patshala. It's at 16 Panthapat, Shukrabad. It's building a community through photo book clubs. It's a talk by Daniel Donnelly and Yoshikatsu Fuji. Fuji, is that the right pronunciation? Yeah, okay. At Patshala. That's 10:30 a.m. tomorrow morning. 12 p.m., it's related, I suppose, dummy book presentation by the participants of the photo book masterclass. That's also at Patshala. This is a workshop that was led by Marcus Chardon and others. The work, he presented the work, he presented his own work earlier, but this is work by the participants. So that'll be shown at 12 p.m. 3 p.m. back here. In fact, every day, 3 p.m., we're back here. Overlaps and Confluences, South Asian Photography. So there's a panel discussion, Prashant Panjiar, Nayantara Gurung Kakshapati, myself, Shahidul Alam. It'll be moderated by Tanzeem Wahab. Tanzeem was here a little while ago. I think he might have left. 4 p.m., Creating Shared Culture, a lecture by Alasdair Foster. Alasdair's, is there? Yeah, there he is. Yeah. Then at 6 p.m., we have A Way of Being, A Way of Seeing, a talk by Martin Borgren. There's Martin. Yeah, hi. 7 p.m., The Pseudo Archive, a talk by Pushpamala N. Pushpamala was also there. There. Thank you. And at 10:30 p.m., this is slightly later than one would normally have it, but this is a video conference with Dwayne Michaels, and because he's in New York, we had to time it so it would be waking hours for him. So at 10:30, Photography and Reality, a talk by Dwayne Michaels, live from New York. That's at Patshala as well. I'm just letting you know. Let's meet up tomorrow again. Make the most of it. Go home safely.